Hi guys, today we will have a look at this vintage Philips compact disc player, model number CD482. It features a 16-bit dual DA converter with 4 times oversampling. So in fact it is one of these nice vintage CD players you can find with remote control facility here. So first thing to notice, the front panel on this one sadly is plastic. It is a very plastic thing, but with Philips anyway you cannot expect very much better things. And if I turn it around, look at that guys, this rear panel. You have the mains socket, plug socket. It is made in Belgium by Philips. I have no manufacturing date on this. Here you have the analog output, and this must be a remote control chain to control several devices with one remote control. So maybe it was part of a bigger stereo system. And look here, guys, it is very interesting. You have these two blank holes exactly at the space, the place where you may have the antenna sockets for VCR or satellite TV receiver. And also this plate here is big enough to fit SCART video, audio video sockets. So it looks like this chassis box here was designed for use in several devices. So it is really a cost-cutting thing. And more interestingly, if we look at the bottom, in fact we have a lot of holes which are not all the purpose of which is not very clear. So it may be a multi-device chassis, and we have a better clue of it when opening it. So of course, as it is Philips, you have the Torx screws, but at least it is not a security Torx. So I will open the cover, put the camera on the vertical stand, and we will have a look inside. First, one more look at the bottom side. As you can see, there was a locking mechanism, locking feature here, which was for transport, which was removed, it seems. You can see the PCB through the holes here. So maybe there are some test points, but it is not really obvious like this. We have a lot of vent holes there and there. So about the top cover. First, the screws are self-tapping Torx screws with a very long thread. So it needs only a few turns to be fully inserted. Probably for saving some seconds in the factory. So that is interesting. And about the top cover, it is stainless, it is steel. And you can see inside there is droplets of black paint from the spray painting, except in these three spots, which I believe are the traces of the magnets or suction cups which were used by the robot or painting machine when painting the cover. Very interesting. So I think they are just auxiliary drops of paint from the spray nozzle. It is not completely painted, and as you don't see the back internal side of the cover, they did not bother at all at this point. But the top was a quite nice black finish. Now let's see what we have inside, guys. I flip it over. So as you can see, There is a bit, first of all, there is a big empty spot here. Nothing at all. So it is one more clue to tell this case for use, it was used for several devices. So here you can see two holes which are covered by a plastic sheet. So about the circuitry, as you can see, it is very compact. You have all on one PCB plus one for the front panel. And as you can see, most of the parts are through hole, all the style through holes. Maybe we just have one or two surface mount clips on the back side. So I am trying to see if I can easily remove the mechanism, but yes, not sure in fact, or maybe yes. So I will try it with you. I should need to remove the drawer, but maybe not easy, so maybe I can just do this. It should be nice to have the see. Oh, it's made the laser drive, but I do not see where all the stuff is connected, so it must be on the bottom. I have one screw here, obviously. Can try to remove this one. Then will it come or not? Ah, I have more screws, so I will remove the panel. So it will be much easier. Just a few seconds. As you can see, these screws are really, really fast and easy to remove. So this kind of connector, as you can see here, is very typical from Philips. You can see them a lot in Philips TVs and so. And here on the front panel, you can see the smaller screws. Yes, so we have one more main drive screw here, obviously. And it should be free, but not yet. Ah, I have one here. In fact, we don't have the most possible annoying place. Okay, so the drawer goes like this. I will put some new lubricant here. Then, now I can remove this last screw and the whole thing should come off. Let's be very careful here because there is a flex circuit. Yes, so here we are. This must be, this is very delicate. So here we have the old skull CD lance mechanism with a galvanometer motor to move the laser assembly. So it is on a very old design here. Quite nice. Then here is the main PCB. So I will zoom on it and back. Here we have the main also. It is some, you know what it is, either some grease or some belt goop. If it is belt goop, I have a problem. Then we have the main transformer here, old school, fuse with fuse holder, the main switch, with this plastic part here, reporting the front push button to the switch. Some maybe power adjusting potentiometers, and here not a lot of ICs. I guess we have some ICs on the other side. You can see a nice copper shielding on over all the PCB. I am trying to find the dead code. I have 1986 here and 1988 here. You can see the mains filtering, rectifying for the main the power buses are made with individual diodes 1N 4002. Quite interesting. So the regulating caps, no problem with them obviously. Output circuitry. And here the main, so two big chips, a Motorola ZC99682P and a Philips SAA7220P/B. Some op-amps here. So I guess it may be good to remove this PCB and check for back bad solders at the back. So it is quite impressive how fast you can take this thing apart. It is only a matter of removing some screws. And now the PCB must be free. I have one more screw here. Don't forget to put this one back in place after. All the same model of screw, almost. Then here is the back side of the PCB. And yes, we have some ICs, just three of them. One Philips SAA7310JP, and two TDA chips, probably for motor controls. So, and a few passive, so the small passive parts also, as you can see. Bigger size SMDs. So I do not see obviously bad solders, but I can see some fun stuff as this transistor here. It is a little not exactly aligned on the pads. Okay. So we will have a look at the last part, the front panel. Just the time to remove these screws. Here are the front panel screws removed, smaller ones. And it just lift straight up. And as you can see, nothing very complicated here. We just have the status LEDs here. The nice orange display here, a LED display, higher receiver on the buttons, on a low cost single sided phenolic board. So this thing is certainly made to a cost. If it is from 1998, yes, it was the big spread out of CD drives. They were becoming less expensive. So they had to make a lot of them at affordable price, I guess. Here is the bottom blocks. You can see. Very, very simple stuff. So, as it is all taken apart, I will clean it completely anyway. And when it is reassembled, we will see if it still works or not. Okay, guys, the thing is together again. I did put some lube on the drawer plastic here. It is connected to my stereo, and to the mains. So we'll hit power up now because I have a switch here. Okay, I can hear some initialization work on the drawer. It happens. I have a little bit too much lube here. It closes. I press shuffle. So not sure if you can see, yes, the display is very dim, but it is nice. So I set track time, and do we have audio? Yes. I will not play audio longer than this because of YouTube copyright bullshit. But it is working nice. So about the indicators, so here you have a phone's plug. You have the main function buttons. You can program it. There is the audio search feature. By default, you will have the track number displayed, but you can select time, and you will see here the indicator changing. If I pause, where is pause? It must be here, yes, pause is here. So seems I have to yes, it is a little weird in operation if I have this thing. It is really old school, but as you can see, it is working, and it is a nice vintage CD drive mechanism inside. So I did purchase it for reselling it, but as always, I may keep it, in fact. So one last thing, funny thing, you can see this wire here, is the front jack wire, but they did route it all the way around in order to avoid all the moving parts in here. But in fact, I believe I could route it this way also. It must be cleaner. I will see. Okay, so thanks for watching. Bye bye.